justice, you need all the help you can get.
You want to get out of here?
No. Mel Gibson is Mad Max. BBC Two, Sunday at 10:10.
You can run, but you can't hide.
The Big Trip on BBC Two, coping with an Australian burger.
Poor little kangaroo.
An Elvis-style wedding provides some American escapism. But it's back to harsh reality when there's an accident in Greece.
Harry and I discovered it about 11 in the morning. Some locals just at the bottom of the cliff face.
Difficult times for the travellers on the Big Trip, Wednesday at 6:45 on BBC Two.
We all remember what life here was like before hospital radio.
Aye, a lot quieter.
We're getting nothing. They're afraid we may be a luxury they can't afford, but they do want to know if we want to do something for the open day next week.
It's open day, but broken hearts have taken over the asylum. Tomorrow at 9 on BBC Two.
Who do you want me to be?
Like you were before.
Gandhi. The name's familiar, but the connection made now on BBC Two is more than imaginative.
Thank you.
recipe for a social disaster.
You know how many kids?
Yes.
On the menu, would they be under starters or main courses?
No, I think I'll need something a bit stronger.
The recipe for convenience. And innovation.
Big cheese, big peas, big cheesy peas. It's easy peasy with cheesy peas. Please.
Fast food? No, all the ingredients for the Fast Show. Tomorrow at 10 on BBC Two.
In a couple of minutes, Monday's News Night. You're watching BBC Two.
There's obviously a lot of smoke in the picture, which we would be complaining bitterly about because we want people to see the colours and the shapes. Whistler, I think, from this painting, is more interested in how the smoke is affecting the landscape than how the gentleness of the carbon dross is just sort of drifting across the sky. What's coming out of the sky is the end of some kind of flicker or carbon dust from the burst of the actual item. The shells have burst or the rockets have burst, and this is the end dross, as we call it, coming down. This is the stuff that you get complaints about because it drifts across the sky and lands on people's car roofs and things. Quite a lot of pathos in it and a soft romance. It's captured what does feel on those wet November nights, you know, with the mist hanging around and the smoke hanging around the fire. Quite an odd thing to choose to watch things dying. I think that had I chosen a subject myself, I would have obviously chosen the moment when the rockets or shells were bursting, because from our point of view, that's what we're painting. We're painting a sky, not a canvas.
Why would you want to eavesdrop on five critics discussing a dead painter?
Oh, it's a nasty little quirk.
Why would you want to hear those critics talking about his work? And why on earth would you want to hear them discussing his mother?
Oh, Mummy, Mummy, it is finished. It is beautiful. And there she is, half dead.
All will be revealed when Omnibus returns with a portrait of Whistler. Tuesday, 10:20, BBC One.
Film 94 is on BBC One in 10 minutes, getting the Barry Norman treatment this week. Terence Stamp in The Adventures of Priscilla, Queen of the Desert. And Quentin Tarantino talks about Pulp Fiction.
It's very easy not to be offended by a book. I mean, all you have to do is shut it. We don't want fake books. Who wants fake books? I wouldn't read one. I wouldn't want to write one. Probably the best way of looking at the whole furore about the Titanic surface is that it's a quarrel between people who have a sense of humour and people who don't.
Now, BBC Two's Newsnight with Peter Snow in London and Jeremy Paxman in Bournemouth.
As American troops arrive in Kuwait, with British reinforcements not far behind, Iraq says it's pulling back. But can either side really claim a victory? Good evening. The confrontation over Kuwait that threatened another Gulf War may be receding tonight, with the Iraqis apparently backing down. But did Saddam Hussein ever intend to do any more than persuade the world to look again at the sanctions imposed on him 3 years ago? At the White House tonight, President Clinton was briefed by his top advisers, and he'll make a television address in 2.5 hours' time. The man who commanded British forces in the Gulf War, General Sir Bertrand Laubilliere, joins us to take the temperature of the crisis. Alexander Haig, former American Secretary of State, and the former French Foreign Minister, Claude Chazal.
Here in Bournemouth, the Conservatives would like to be looking forward to a week of bold declarations by ministers and confidence basking in the achievements of the last couple of years. Instead, they find themselves struggling to keep their heads above a tide of allegations that after so long in power, they've lost all sense of propriety. I'll be asking the Conservative Party's chairman, Jeremy Hanley, what are the limits of acceptable behaviour for Conservative MPs and ministers, and also whether it's right for the Tory leadership to be comparing the sincerity of Tony Blair with that of Gerry Adams. Also, what's acceptable and what's not acceptable when it comes to reforms of the welfare state? Peter Kellner has opinion poll results.
All that later. Now, there's still an element of doubt around tonight as to whether Saddam Hussein is backing off from Kuwait. Iraq's ambassador to the United Nations says that in the light of concerns within the Security Council, Iraqi troops are already moving back. But the Pentagon in Washington tonight says there's no indication of any Iraqi withdrawal underway, and it, for its part, is still piling troops into Kuwait. Britain has told 800 men of the Royal Marines and a battery of light guns to fly up within the next 24 hours unless there's firm evidence of an Iraqi withdrawal. The Kuwaiti information minister said just over an hour ago that he believed a Kuwaiti withdrawal when he saw one, an Iraqi withdrawal when he saw one. Now, clearly, we won't know what's really happening on the ground for some time yet, but what has been Saddam Hussein's game plan these past few days? Iraq's line throughout has been that it hopes the world will focus its attention on how sanctions are hurting the Iraqi people. But will the effect of all this be to ease sanctions or to strengthen the case for them? Robin Denslow reports.
He marched them up to the Kuwaiti border, and he marched them back again. The grand old Duke of York, the second son of George III and the commander of the English army in the Netherlands, was immortalised in nursery rhyme after his forces were routed by the French. Today, 200 years on, Saddam's estimated 80,000 troops down by the Kuwaiti border were reported to be pulling back, leaving everyone guessing as to his next move, his next potential act of wild brinkmanship. The United States have been taking no chances. As the first 300 forces arrived in Kuwait, it was announced there'd soon be 200 American aircraft and 36,000 troops in the region. Britain, for its part, is sending a battalion, a second warship, and 6 fighter aircraft. So, what is Saddam playing at? Iraqi television today showed recruits eager to sign up for the front, just as his UN envoy was announcing the troop withdrawal.
The Iraqi government has decided to move the troops from the Basra area to another area, and therefore to relocate them, and also that we reserve the right to move them anytime in the future to wherever we want within the Iraqi territory.
Saddam's stated aim is certainly clear: to make the world take note of the effects of the UN sanctions imposed after Iraq's invasion of Kuwait back in August 1990.
The sanctions have stopped Iraq from exporting the source of virtually all its revenue, which is oil. So you've had massive inflation, shortages, growing unemployment. And I think beyond that, a sense that the country has no future. And what Iraqis coming out of Iraq have said to me is that people are willing to hang on if they thought there'd be an end to it. But it's gone on now for 4 years. They feel there's no end in sight.
One British politician who's visited Iraq and met Saddam this year is Labour MP George Galloway. He was severely reprimanded by his party leadership after appearing to honour the Iraqi president on television during his visit to Baghdad in January.
People like me in this country, trying to make our voices heard and being ignored about the suffering of the Iraqi people, nobody would have even reported in any real depth the reconfirmation of sanctions this week. And yet now, because he's taken this action, Iraq, and by extension, the suffering of its people, are the number one item on the news throughout the world. So as a piece of armed propaganda, that should be rather effective.
So if Saddam really wants this pressure removed, how is marching towards Kuwait and back again possibly going to help? The ceasefire agreement at the end of the Gulf War in 1991 laid down conditions that have to be met before sanctions can be lifted. The Iraqi government has to recognize the newly drawn boundaries of Kuwait, allow their weapons of mass destruction to be disposed of, and return or account for all Kuwaiti prisoners of war. Rolf Ekias, the UN commissioner, had been due to present a report to the Security Council today on Iraq's compliance with UN resolutions over weapons manufacture and announced the start of a new long-term monitoring program. But a dispute over the wording has led to a delay until tomorrow at the earliest. What's his verdict going to be?
What Ekias is apparently going to say is, Iraq has complied with the demands about getting rid of the long-range missiles and then nuclear and chemical and biological facilities. The Americans are going to say is, A, we've got to test this out, monitor him for some months at least before we even consider lifting sanctions. But they're also going to say that actually he's been hiding. He's been hiding 40-ton missiles, he's been hiding some of his biological capabilities and so on. So there's going to be an argument even about the chaos support.